Hi, this is Deacon John Wilson here. I'm the Education Enrichment Director for West Angeles Church. And I thought I would in two-part video, cover a little bit about Black history. In this first video, I'm going to talk about three famous Black Americans, I think the most important ones. In fact, it would be very hard if you were to mention, say, the top 20 Americans who ever lived, maybe top 30. I'd say 20. It'd be hard to keep these three out. I thought I would not cover Dr. Martin Luther King. I covered him on his birthday, and everybody knows what he did. I thought I would cover three other ones and give you some insights on them that maybe you never thought of or never heard of. Three great Black Americans for you to learn about today with me. So here we are, three greatest Black Americans I put other than Martin Luther King Jr. So let's take a look at this closely. The first one I like to talk about is Booker T. Washington. Some have recognized him as the father of Black colleges because of his contribution with the founding of Tuskegee Institute. But there were a couple of Black colleges that preceded it. I would say quite a few. So I don't think you can really say that, but he's certainly a great thinker. And as you see in a moment, I had some great quotes. Relatively short life, I suppose, 56 years old when he passed. Pretty controversial figure to some today who are, extremely engaged in the Black civil rights movement, I suppose you could call it. That's another conversation, because today many revisionists have criticized him for a speech that he made. They call it the Atlanta Compromise, but I won't get too much into that, I don't think, today. Let's look at some of his great, he was a great man though, great educator. Let's learn a little bit about him, but let's first learn about his life, some quotes that he made first. I think that would be appropriate, okay? I have learned that success is to be measured not so much by the position that one has reached in life as by the obstacles which he has overcome while trying to succeed. You'll see that recurring theme on all three of these young folks who are watching. He's saying to work hard to get ahead. You don't deserve things just because you're breathing, you could fog a mirror up. You deserve success because you've overcome things, you've worked hard. I will permit no man to narrow and degrade my soul by making me hate him. What a wonderful thing. These men and women of God all were religious too, by the way, as was the case with many of our early founding fathers. They believed in God. They followed God. And they were concerned not to have hate in their heart. No man. Those who are happiest are those who do the most for others. Amen. By the way, I'll provide you a copy of this presentation. Look down in the description box. You can click and have it to look through. I hope there are a lot of you students that will look through these. And anybody else who's interested. There is another class of colored people who make a business of keeping the troubles, the wrongs, the hardships of the Negro race, they said Negro then, before the public. Having learned that they are able to make a living out of their troubles, they have grown into a settled habit of advertising their wrongs, partly because they want sympathy, partly because it pays. So some people are stirring up race stuff because it pays, and it's in their best interest to keep things the way they are. Some of these people do not want the Negro to lose his grievances. They don't want him to get everything taken care of because they don't want to lose their jobs. It seems a little cynical, but even back then, he recognized there were race hustlers. And we do have race hustlers still today, just in it for themselves, making millions of dollars. A lie doesn't become truth. Wrong doesn't become right. and evil doesn't become good just because it's accepted by a majority. Ooh, that's so true. We got to do what's right, young folks, no matter what other people think. Shouldn't be dependent on what they think. Success is not measured by the position one has reached in life, rather by the obstacles one overcomes while trying to succeed. In order to be successful in any undertaking, I think the main thing is for one to grow to the point where he completely forgets himself. How about that? That is to lose himself in a great cause. Some reason why you're here. I pray that every college student who hears this will get an answer to the question of why am I here, Lord? What's my purpose? In proportion, as one loses himself in this way, in the same degree does he get the highest happiness out of his work. Let's look at Booker T. Washington's life summary here. I put together a few notes. He was born in slavery in 1856 in Hales Ford, Virginia. He was freed when the U.S. troops reached his area during the Civil War. As a young man, Booker T. Washington worked his way through Hampton Normal and Agricultural Institute and attended college at Wayland Seminary. Now, he was living way over in Western Virginia, and it is said that he walked to Hampton on the East Coast, about 400 miles at least. In 1881, he was named as the first leader of the new Tuskegee Institute in Alabama, an institute for Black higher education. So really, it was there and was founded. He's not the founder, but he's probably its greatest leader. He expanded the college, enlisting students in the construction of buildings. And he raised a lot of money. He raised like millions of dollars, which in today's money is tens of millions of dollars. I think he raised like $5 million, which is like $45 million today. He expanded the college, enlisting students, so the students in the school built the buildings. Work at the college was considered fundamental to their larger education. Can you imagine that today? You know, of course, they have volunteers on campus doing things for the university, but he had them building buildings. He attained national prominence for his Atlanta address of 1895. That's come to be known by many who are more progressive today as the Atlanta Compromise, but the proper thing to call is the Atlanta Address of 1895. You ought to read up on it. It's a very interesting self-empowerment message for that time. And it was not initially criticized, but after he died or later in his life, people like W.E.B. Du Bois began to criticize him. It attracted attention of politicians and the public. I think he was invited to the White House at that time. So first Black in the White House since Frederick Douglass. We'll talk about that later. Washington played a dominant role in the Black politics, winning wide support in the Black community of the South and among more liberal whites. Washington wrote an autobiography, Up From Slavery, in 1901, also very controversial today. Again, another message of self-empowerment, working hard, which became a major text. In that year, he dined with Theodore Roosevelt, there it is, at the White House, which was the first time a Black person publicly met a president on equal terms, Booker T. Washington. Next, we have Madam C.J. Walker, 1867 to 1919. Here's some quotes by her first. A lot of you know about what she did, but I think I'll do the quotes first. Don't sit down and wait for the opportunities to come. Get up and make them happen. Don't you see this common theme that all these early Black leaders, Black societal leaders, work for what you're going to get. Don't sit down and expect people to do things for you. If I have accomplished anything in life, it's because I've been willing to work hard. There it is again. I'm not satisfied in making money for myself. I endeavor to provide employment for hundreds of women of my race. There is no royal flower strewn path to success. So you're not going to have just an easy pathway to be successful. You're going to work hard. You're going to have two steps backwards and then four steps forward. Two steps backward, four forward. That's where it's going to be in college. You got to work hard. But whatever success I have and attained is the result. There it is again, much hard work and many sleepless nights. But see, today, a lot of people, a lot of leaders say that we're victims. This is why I don't think, I want you to think you're a victim. You're not owed anything. You got to go get it. Let's look at her life. Madam C.J. Walker was an African-American entrepreneur, philanthropist, political and social activist. She's recorded as the first female, listen to this, self-made millionaire in America. There were women before that were millionaires, but they inherited. But she was a self-made millionaire. Walker made her fortune by developing and marketing a line of cosmetics and hair care products for Black women through the business she founded, Madam C.J. Walker Manufacturing Company. She became known for her philanthropy. She's a great giver and activism. She made financial donations to numerous organizations, such as the NAACP, and became a patron of the arts. By the way, she met Booker T. Washington two or three times, and there was some correspondence between them. Because they had common objectives. They commonly respected each other. Villa Luaro, it's her house, her lavish estate at Irvington, New York, served as a social gathering place for African-American community. Understand it's a museum now. At the time of her death, she was considered the wealthiest African-American businesswoman and wealthiest self-made Black woman in America. Isn't that something? Madam C.J. Walker. Then we go to my favorite, Frederick Douglass, 1818 to 1895. You know, he died in Washington, D.C., and he lived in a place called the Frederick Douglass House. And that Frederick Douglass House is in D.C., and we're going to visit that. I'm leading a group of students to D.C. in July. I hope your student can come. We'll have details very soon about it. But when I visit his house, I feel so many warm feelings about a man who was not college educated. He's an amazing man. Let's get to some of his famous quotes. Knowledge unfits a child to be a slave. I love that. Knowledge unfits a child to be a slave. So youth, what he's saying is if you don't, you're not a lover of knowledge and want to learn your subjects and learn about life and get ahead, you deserve what you get. You won't get much. Intelligence is a great leveler. Here as elsewhere, intelligence. Education means emancipation. Wow. It means light and liberty. It means uplifting of the soul of man at the glorious light of truth, the light by which men can only be made free. How about that? Fortune may crowd a man's life with fortunate circumstances and happy opportunities, but they will, as we all know, avail him nothing unless he makes a wise and vigorous use of them. How about that? Opportunity is important, but exertion is indispensable. Exertion meaning exerting the energy. See, all three of these talk about you have to work hard to get ahead. We may explain success mainly by one word, and that word is work, work, work. Actually, four words, but it's the same word. There we go. Don't you see that theme? Got to work hard to get ahead. It's a self-made success. It's not dependent on anybody, including the white man. Sometimes when you hear people blaming the white man and telling you white man this, white man that, and we need reparations and all that stuff, it's kind of a subtle glorification of white man. Let's get our eyes as a people, as a community, let's get our eyes off the white man and get our eyes on our community first and making it better. I have more to say about that in a video coming up. And then on ourselves to make us better people. Whew. The man who will get up will be helped up. If you get up, they'll help you up. You don't want to do more for people than they want to do for themselves. Frederick Douglass, he's the man. And the man who will not get up will be allowed to just stay down. So you got to want to get up to be picked up. We succeed not only by the laborious exertions of our faculties, be they small or great, but by the regular, thoughtful, and systematic exercise of them. We've got to exercise our gifts, the things we're created by the good Lord with that will help others. It has to be laborious, it says. Laborious exertions of our faculties. Let's talk about his life. I got quite a bit about his life. Let's talk about it. Frederick Douglass was born as Frederick Augustus Washington Bailey. He always kept the name Frederick, but he had two other names, or maybe one other name than Bailey, before he became Frederick Douglass. Historians think it's because he was an escaped slave. He was the first African-American citizen to hold a high U.S. rank. Yeah, he held two or three offices in government. When he died, he was the Marshal of Washington, D.C. He's best known as the civil rights leader in the abolition movement and for advocating the education for the advancement of African-Americans. I should add here, he also, at the end of his life, was a leading organizer, organizing women for the right to vote. They would get it years later, of course, but his wife at the time and him were big organizers. Through his escape, he changed his last name from Bailey to Johnson, then Johnson to Douglas, like I said, but he never changed his first name. His mother was Harriet Bailey, a slave. His father was a white man, believed to be his master, Aaron Anthony. How about that? His mother was the only colored woman. And by the way, if you get this document, you can click on these links and learn more about this. Just go on my, look in the description block, click on the link, you'll see this presentation. His mother was the only colored woman in Tuckahoe who could read. Yeah, you know that had an effect on him. He was uneducated, but he taught himself. Listen, he continued to learn to read and write with the Webster spelling book, which he carried everywhere he went. He practiced writing in a board fence, brick wall, and on the pavement. He taught himself to read and write. Amazing. When he was about 12 years old, Douglass bought the Columbian Orator, which is a book, gave him a new concept of freedom. He bought the journal with the money he had earned from polishing boots. Is that hard work again? He found out the meaning of abolition by reading the Baltimore American, which was a newspaper. So he learned about abolitionism. And you know, he's probably the greatest abolitionist of all time, him and Garrison. Frederick's first wife was a black free woman named Anna Douglas. Okay, his second wife was a white woman, Ellen Pitts. Bet you didn't know that. She was 20 years younger, and their families each did not approve of the interracial marriage. How about that? That's something interesting to learn about Frederick Douglass, isn't it? Frederick and Anna Douglas had five children, three sons and two daughters. Rosetta, Louis, Henry, Frederick, Charles Raymond, that's right, and Annie. Their youngest daughter, Annie, died when she was 10 years old. Despite efforts, Anna Douglas never succeeded in learning to read or write. It's interesting. He met William Garrison, famous abolitionist, and William Coffin, both of them are great abolitionists. In New England, they offered him a job as an agent for the Massachusetts anti-slavery movement. Okay? Society. During the 1850s, he would tour 6 months a year giving speeches. In fact, his greatest was in 1852 on July 5th. Very well-known speech. He was a second choice speaker. The regular speaker didn't show up. That's a very historic speech. You should look it up. During the winter of 1855 to 56, he covered 5,000 miles, wow, and gave 70 speeches. Douglass's sons, Charles and Louis, were the first two colored recruits to join the 54th Massachusetts Infantry during the Civil War. His son Frederick worked as a recruiter. By the way, that black division there, 54th, was featured in the movie Glory. More about his life. Douglas met President Lincoln three times. Some people believe they had met more than three, but this says three. Seems like I read a book that said they meet about five or six times. All during the war, by the way. Not after. He didn't see President Lincoln at all. After the war, he died 2 weeks later. He was a Republican. And that's going to upset some of y'all, but he was a Republican. In fact, him and Lincoln are thought to be some of the early founders of the Republican Party in that way. Black people in that time are all Republicans. Lincoln was a Republican. Some of y'all will say, well, what changed? But that's another whole story. It's actually a rather amazing story. And one day, maybe I'll do some history classes online and I'll talk about that. If somebody's interested, let me know. His salary in the American Slavery Society was $450 a year. When slavery was abolished, he was paid from $50 to $100 per speech. I think I figured that out. He was paid like $4,000 to $5,000 per speech. His most famous speech was Self-Made Men. See, there is again that idea of pulling yourself up and taking care of yourself. Douglas lived in Rochester, New York for 25 years, longer than anywhere else he had lived in his life. So he moved to D.C., only lived there a few years. After escaping from slavery, he had devoted his life to abolishing slavery. When slavery was abolished, he advocated for civil rights, the advancement of his race. Frederick Douglass died of a massive heart attack. He died right in the lobby of his house in Cedar Hill, Washington, D.C., Southeast Washington, Anacostia, at the age of 77. It's right before his 78th birthday. There you have it. Three great Americans, Booker T. Washington, Madam C.J. Walker, and Frederick Douglass. May we emulate their hard work and their ingenuity and their use of their faculties and their desire to not be a victim. May we learn from that in this great Black History Month. Thank you very much. God bless you.